Spring football in the books, and it has been for quite some time across the nation, just about everywhere except for a few spots in the Pac-12, including UCLA. We got Tony Siracusa on the line to talk up the Bruins. Tony, we appreciate you stopping by as always. I'm just looking forward to the update on UCLA football. I want to see this program succeed. I'm generally not in the rooting interest of anyone across the country. Keep it pretty neutral here, our coverage of college football, except for my beloved Buckeyes. But besides that, I would like to see UCLA get back into it. And Chip Kelly's obviously had a three-year run that has not met any type of expectations. But as the team played a little bit better last year, it certainly, again, it was still miles away from seriously competing in the conference. But as things stack up, based on what you've observed, what are the major storylines out of camp?
It's been an unusual camp, Mark, and because usually what happens with UCLA being on the quarter system is they start camp around early April, early March to mid-March. They take a break, 1 week break, because they get spring break in there, and then they come back, have a few more weeks, and then the spring scrimmage. They didn't do that this year because of COVID, sort of. That was what we were told by the administration. Chip Kelly actually broke it down better for us. It was because of the NCAA calendar. Any athlete who left campus for any purpose for an extended period of time to go home for spring break had to come back and go under 7-day isolation because of COVID protocols in the state. The NCAA was going to count those 7 days against UCLA's allowable practice time. And so that would have compressed everything. So what they did was they waited until after spring break. UCLA and Stanford are the two schools out on the West Coast that have done that. So they got a really late start. They are just now about the halfway point, or maybe even three quarters point of spring break, while everybody else has been done for a couple of weeks. There have been a couple of significant changes, of course. They have a new quarterbacks coach, Ryan Gunderson, who we got to meet with a couple of days ago. And the new wide receivers coach, who is a name that most people will know very well, at least the last name, because he is Jerry Neuheisel, son of Rick. And he is being promoted from grad assistant to wide receivers coach. And so those are some pretty big steps. And we got a chance to meet with Gunderson. That alone is a big change, because for the 3+ years of the Chip Kelly era, no assistant coach has been allowed to go on the record with the media at UCLA. There's been none. We put in the request and they die on the vine. Chip says it's the media relations department. Media relations says they never heard back from the coach. We've spoken to people up at Oregon who covered Chip while he was with the Ducks, and they said that's the way Chip is. He doesn't like his assistants going on the record. But it's a new world with a new athletic director at UCLA, and maybe that's the motivating factor. But we got interviews in the past 2 weeks with Jerry Neuheisel and Ryan Gunderson. It's interesting because Gunderson, look, there's one quarterback right now at UCLA. It is Dorian Thompson-Robinson. Chip Kelly has proclaimed he is the starter. His flaws and all, there is no quarterback race. It is Dorian versus Dorian, as Chip told us. Dorian is competing against himself to try and make himself better, get rid of the mistakes, improve his skills. And when we talked to Gunderson the other day, man, he was effusive about Dorian, about the skills that he has and the physical skills. And Gunderson was a quarterback back in the day at Oregon State, not a very accomplished one, but he was. And he said his goal now, he's not to tinker with DTR's game so much as his thinking process and making sure he's getting the right reads and thinking his way through the game a little bit better. That puts Chase Griffin, you know, in a very definitive backup spot, and as well as Ethan Garbers, the transfer from Washington. And that has been news on the UCLA campus as well. Garbers looks fantastic in camp. We've been out to see camp a few times, and he looks fantastic, but he's currently ineligible because of the University of Washington. Now, you and I both know the NCAA put out a blanket dictum that all players get a one-time transfer without having to sit out for free. That one time. Washington is not granting Garbers the waiver. there is a loophole buried deep in the weeds about when he signed his letter of intent, where his residence was, what his and when he enrolled at Washington, and they're using that to not grant the waiver. This is the second player from Washington to transfer to UCLA where Washington will not grant the waiver. UCLA is likely to have to appeal to the Pac-12 or to the NCAA to get it done. Washington's going the pretty vindictive route. So there are three very good quarterbacks in camp, but it is DTR's job right now.
Tony, is there a spot on this team that you're extremely concerned about? And if it doesn't get shored up, that's really going to be a focus in August, whether that be from just a quality standpoint or a depth standpoint?
Yeah, I think there are two things to look at, on the good and the concern. We won't call it bad. We'll call it a concern. Look, UCLA, this is the most experienced team Chip is ever going to have. He lost two players off last year's team, Demetric Felton at running back and Osa Odighizuwa at defensive line. So you've got everybody returning. I think ESPN put out a stat that they are number two in the country in returning production in terms of players coming back. But the defensive line is a concern because even though you only lost one player, there was not a lot of depth there to begin with. And you're looking at it and at camp, and they're not getting a lot of push on the quarterback right now. So there's some concern there, and an injury or two is going to hurt that defensive line significantly. The linebackers look improved. The defensive backs look tremendously improved. On the real upside, what you're looking at is a stable of running backs. I mean, at UCLA, and I asked Chip Kelly specifically the other day, is it possible that you go into the season without a number one running back? You just have running back by committee because they're all that skilled. They have Britton Brown returning for a sixth year. The grad transfer decided to take up the NCAA on their free year. And they have Zach Charbonnet transferring from Michigan. And they already had a couple of guys like Kaz Allen, who is back for another year. He's small, but tremendous speed. And I'm going to tell you, Charbonnet looks amazing in camp right now. I mean, just a north-south runner who is just blowing through the line and through the linebackers, blowing people up on contact. So, you know, UCLA's got everybody back. They, like I said, lost one running back, but they are loaded at running back. They've got all the receivers back, added a couple of transfers. Really, this is a no-excuse year. This is it. You've got to pull out a significant number of wins and at least a second-tier bowl game.
So is there a spring game or some semblance of a spring finale scheduled?
There's a spring we're done with camp event. How's that? There's no spring scrimmage. They took what was the last day scheduled for spring, and there will be a spring exhibit that is closed to everybody but the media. And even media access has yet to be determined. So they will run live action plays and don't know who's going to get to see it. I mean, I assume the media will to some degree. The media has been kept at a distance. We've been allowed into camp. We've been allowed to see it, but the live action drills have been at the farthest part away from the media that you could possibly get. And there was a lot of haranguing. We were very vocal on social media about it. And I know for our part of Last Word on College Football, we included that in a lot of articles about, if you want to know, you know, how these drills went, ask the people hanging out in the parking lot because they saw it better than we did. And all of a sudden, we were allowed, you know, some more access to it, a little bit, not a lot, but a little bit, sufficient amounts. So we don't know what will happen, but basically on the 27th, that will be the end of UCLA spring camp, and they'll just go quietly into their summer drills. Now, it's worth noting, the most significant thing is to come out of this healthy, because you had camp so late, and UCLA plays its first game in week zero at home against Hawaii, which means you're going to start fall camp early. So if there are any significant injuries, there's very little turnaround time during the summer. You're looking at about no more than 5 weeks, maybe six, before you're ready to start fall camp.
Tony Siracusa, Last Word on College Football, breaking down the Bruins for us. And again, join him on Last Word on College Football for the complete wrap on UCLA, the Pac-12, and beyond. Tony, we always appreciate you stopping by.
Always glad to do it, Mark.